So if you look at that infograph, it actually tells you how the paper is built. So I brought up the element of financial accounting because tax, as we know it, relies a lot on accounting information. If you look at the presumptive tax for you know, small businesses, you'll notice that actually the turnover that is used to arrive at the decision that this individual falls under the presumptive tax treatment is an accounting record. Even corporations, we start from a tax position, we start from a profit position, sorry. Then we go back to arrive at a chargeable income. So for you in preparation, it's very important that actually you have an understanding of financial accounting. I wouldn't advise anyone to come for this paper without first completing the financial accounting paper. And then secondly, is business law. Now, if you notice that the tax we studied is mostly law. There's accounting, yes, but there's a lot of law that we study in taxation. So for you to be able to comfortably see this paper, you must have a good understanding of business law, or I would advise you must have completed that that paper three, I think. I'm not sure whether it's a requirement, the institute maybe can tell us, but I don't know whether it's a requirement that before you register for six, you must have done one and three, but I would strongly advise that you first complete one and three before you actually go for paper six. Because we talk about apps, apps are laws. We talk about maybe, you know, case laws. There's a lot of case law that we refer to. For example, if you don't find the definition of a certain item in the Income Tax Act, where are you going to go? The first place to go to is to go to case law. Is it defined in the Act? No, it's not. You may not find that definition there, but that definition is already there by case law. And case law provides a lot of information for us. I would actually advise, especially as you go through to paper 9, that you start building cases to understand what's happening in the world of taxation. So the two financial accounting and business law are very important for you to effectively be able to do paper 6. And paper 6 is a direct build-up to paper 9, which is advanced taxation. So when you complete 6, the next paper you're going to face is paper 9. And like I said earlier, you'll actually notice that there are things that are not examined in paper 6 and they are reserved for paper 9 because that's an advanced level. Things to do with international taxation, things to do with apportionments, VAT, and some other areas of which are considered more advanced. And at that level of paper 9, you actually expect that you can comfortably provide guidance to businesses out there on tax matters. We shall proceed as they set the projector. But the next thing that is covered in your syllabus is the level of assessment. And there are basically two. One is that you should be able to demonstrate you are tested on your understanding of legal framework in Uganda. And the legal framework you're focused on and interested in here is basically those that are directly related to taxation. And then the general tax administration. So you notice that your level of assessment will definitely fall between these two general components. There are two sections, the section A and section B. Now, section A is objectives. There are multiple choice questions, you should be able to cycle one. My advice is always, even if you do not know a question in objective, you better gamble it. Do not leave a question unanswered or unattempted in the objective section of the paper. And that is normally 20 marks. So you can see how, you know, you can start accumulating marks to make your pass mark, which I think is 50. Section B, there are 5 questions. 4 of those are directly tax questions, and then 1 is an entrepreneurship question. Why do we tax? Why must we pay taxes? Right? So this is the theoretical bit that students have to understand. And this is very important for you to appreciate the entire course. Before you go into the details of computation of tax and so forth, you should be able to understand and demonstrate knowledge that you actually know the history of taxes and why taxes are being charged. That is under the introduction to tax administration in Uganda. If you look at the nature and the scope of tax, that will include things like classification of taxes, progressive tax, regressive tax, proportionate tax. If somebody asks, for example, is VAT a progressive tax? Okay? It's a good question. Do we have progressive tax in Uganda? Because we know what progressive taxes are. That the rate of the tax increases with the rate of income. Right? So is VAT a progressive tax? What are regressive taxes? Do we have some of those? Is there a tax in Uganda that is regressive? That as your income reduces, the tax actually increases. Still under the nature and the scope of tax, it includes things like taxable capacity. We know that taxable capacity is the ability of an individual to pay taxes rather than the authority to collect taxes. We've been having a lot of debate in this country about the ability of URA to raise revenue, So when we are discussing taxable capacity, are we talking about URA ability to raise revenue, or we are talking about our own individual's ability to pay taxes? There are elements of compliance that can be examined. What is tax compliance? I can ask a question. If I pay all my taxes, but I pay them 10 days later, have I complied? Right? You can say yes, then you'll have to explain why you say yes. Have I complied? Compliance includes things like timely payment. So therefore, when I pay my taxes late, I haven't actually complied. It's not just about paying the taxes, but it's also paying it rightly, the right amount, the right time, and without being compelled to pay those taxes. So compliance is part of your syllabus, and examiners can bring this, I think, mostly in section A of the question. Maybe before I start talking about the Act, do we all have copies of the Act, the Tax Act? Okay, so one of the things I'll challenge you after this discussion is please go back. There are two options. Option one, you can go to town and buy the Act, a printed one. Option two, you can go to URA's website and download it. Now, chances are, when you go to URA's website to download, you may not download the latest version of the Act. When that happens, you may then need to go ahead and download the different amendments, okay, up to the last amendment of last year, because we shall be seeing that those amendments and those changes in tax laws is one of the most difficult things for students. Someone downloads the Act as it was in 2017 and is not for any reason motivated to understand the changes. And the examiners will set the most recent version of the Act. They will set things that are most recent. And because of that, most students will get them wrong. And we shall see that in tax, once you get one thing wrong, chances are you're going to lose 5 to 6 to 7 marks. Because that particular adjustment actually has a flow-on effect on the other parts of the question. So, accounting methods, that's where I was, which is under the scope, nature and scope of tax. It's basically from section 39 to section 48 of the Act. Once you get the Act, you should be able to read. It will talk about so many things on accounting methods, and examiners can examine those. The tax structure in Uganda. When this question comes, normally examiners tell us that students do not do well at all. We're talking about the executive. What part does the executive play in the tax administration? And you know what the executive is in this country. Or what part does the parliament play in tax administration? Most times for me, my job involves telling people what the effect of a specific tax policy is going to be. For example, if the government is going to start charging people OTT, my role is to tell institutions that, look, OTT is going to have ABCD challenges given ABCD circumstances. That's what my job is on most days. So, what role does Parliament play in tax administration? Who manages Uganda Revenue Authority? There was, I think it was 2017, this question was set, An examiner has told us in their comments that students do not do well. Most people do not know who appoints the Commissioner General, for example. So we should be able to interest ourselves in understanding this. Like I said, this is a knowledge paper, but it's also a foundation paper. So they will examine things that are related to this. The next part of your syllabus is the income tax, you know, which is a very interesting, but also very rich area. But it starts from income tax is imposed in section 4 of the Act, you know, and we know that income tax is tax that is charged on income earned from employment, from business, and from property. Students mistake pay as you earn as a form of tax. No, pay as you earn is a method of collecting income tax from employment. So we should be able to understand some of these details. Like I said, income tax under section 4 of the Act, once you get it, is tax that is charged on income earned from employment, from property, and from business. Anything else is just under those. When you talk about dividends, it's property income. When you talk about rent, it's property income because you're earning income from property. And I think that is handled in section 20 of the Act. Pay as you earn is employment income, and then the rest is business. So there are basically three categories: business, employment, and property. Now, the under Income Tax Act, they will talk about resident status, which is section 9 of the Act. Who is a resident person? If you have been, I don't know how far you have gone with your level of preparations, but one of the things that you'll encounter is residency, which is section 9 of the Act. Am I a resident? And why is residence important? Does it matter if I'm not a resident in this country? Yes, it does, because the Act tells us that residents are charged on income that is earned from all over the world, provided you're a resident. Non-residents are charged on only income that is earned from Uganda. So it takes you to source rule, which I think is in section 79 of the Act. So once you're a resident, your income is taxed worldwide. Now, examiners will bring these things. They will not mention, they will not tell you that this person is a resident and therefore we are charging income from all over. No, they will bring you scenarios. Although international tax is not examined at your level, but a resident person can be examined on income that is sourced from Rwanda, that is sourced from Sudan, Dubai, or any other country. Dubai is United Arab Emirates. So, you should be able to know that. And how do you determine that someone is a resident? There are three tests, right? And this is something that when you start reading the Act, you'll be very conversant with. One, you have a permanent residence in Uganda. Two, how long have you been staying in Uganda for that year of income? And then three, if you're a government employee, you're definitely a resident. The same applies to companies. The same applies to partnerships and retirement fund. And then trust as well. For companies, there are also three tests. The formation test, is the company formed in Uganda? Definitely it's a resident in Uganda. Is the company having its operations in Uganda? And thirdly, it's its management here in Uganda. So those are the tests that you'll be able to read and understand. We don't have that much time to go and discuss everything about residency, but it's a very rich area and it's very interesting. We all remember Airtel and say, Airtel bought say. So the question that matter, the transfer of ownership between Airtel, this is they're recording, but it's an open, it's public information. The transfer of ownership between Zain to Airtel was actually challenged in court because both companies are not registered in Uganda, but URA went ahead and assessed them. So the question is, can you assess tax from someone who is not a resident? And that particular tax we're talking about is capital gains tax, which I'll also look at. I think one of the topics is about capital gains tax. So it's an area that students need to take a lot of interest in, and examiners will be twisting questions around that area. But you need not to be caught off guard. You should master what forms residency, who is not a resident, and how that has an impact on their tax position. The next thing is about year of assessment. That is under income tax. The syllabus requires you to know what year of assessment is. Is it a normal year? We know that the normal year is 1st July to 30th June. But most companies operate 1st January to 31st December. So that is called substituted year of income. And that is also there in the Act. And so how is it important? What about the period between 1st July and 31st December? That's what the Act calls transitional year. How relevant is that? For example, the laws, the tax laws are normally passed in June with the budget. It's effective 1st July. So if my year of income is 31st December, what happens between 1st July and 31st December? Do I take the benefits of the amendments? Or do I have to, you know, wait until my next year comes? I think there's actually a matter there that went to court. Like I said, you need to be taking interest in some of these things that are happening, the current affairs and how things are. It's normally news, read the newspapers. It's there in the part of the newspaper that no one wants to read under business. That's where you'll find some of these tax issues. Okay? So these are all very relevant and they're examinable in your syllabus. The next thing is employment income. That is section 19. I want to mention six things about employment income and I would ask you to write them down because this is one area that students get a lot of challenges in. The first one is the treatment of motor vehicle benefit. I do not know, maybe just a few questions, exam questions, are set without motor vehicle benefits in employment income. Now, the amendment of 2018 changed the treatment for motor vehicle benefits. They started allowing depreciation on motor vehicle benefits. Examiners like it a lot. So they will definitely bring these areas for you and you need to be conversant with it. So you need to read how the treatment for motor vehicle benefits is done. That is one area that gives students a lot of challenges from the comments that you get from examination papers. The second one is housing benefit. I'll ask a question. If I'm giving an accommodation to my staff, right? The accommodation includes a big house and boys' quarters. Do you also value the boys' quarters? Right? We don't. Okay? The boys' quarters are not valued. So it's actually provided for in a statutory subsidiary regulation in the Act that the boys' quarters have no value. But examiners will bring this, and sometimes they'll put a figure, they'll say, in the market, these units of maids' houses are valued at 500,000 per month. They're testing your ability to say, no, for tax purposes, we don't value this. Now, housing benefit, computation of housing benefit requires that you provide a test, right? That means that you first compute all the benefits as if the housing benefit is also part of that benefit and then subject it to a 15% test. Most students, according to comments that we get from examination papers, do not provide those tests. And that's one area that disturbs people. So housing benefit, note that down. There are two benefits that are also very common. Housekeepers versus security. Security benefits is not, it's not taxable. There's a practice note to that effect. But housekeepers are taxable. So note those two. Another one is, another tricky area that I want you to pay attention to is benefits that are provided on annual basis and those that are provided on monthly basis and those that are provided on quarterly basis. The examiner will bring gross income for, let's say, for anybody, for Peter, gross salary per month. Then we'll provide all the benefits, monthly benefits, what have you. And then at the end, they'll ask you to compute his chargeable income for the year, right? So the examiner is expecting you to extrapolate the 1 month salary times 12. Now, they can also bring annual salary and say, compute the benefit for 1 month. So this is one area that has disturbed students a lot. According to the comments that we see, the examiners have told us that this area disturbs students a lot. And it's one of the areas that I want you to take interest in. I think those are the key areas in employment income. The rest are readable. Take note of life insurance. It's one interesting area. Take note of medical insurance versus medical reimbursement. So your syllabus covers comprehensively all those elements I've mentioned. And if you go to section 19 of the Act, once you get the Act, you should be able to read and understand some of those things. I'll briefly talk about business income. One thing I want you to note about business income is presumptive tax. Presumptive tax is not a tax in itself. It's a method of collecting income tax from business owners who have small businesses whose threshold is less than 150 million. That is turnover. Now, this comes in either section A or section B. In section A, the examiner will give you a scenario, and scenarios are important. You need to read them to understand what the examiner wants. And will ask you, what is the chargeable income, for example, right? And then students go and compute. This person had sales of 120 million, they had expenses, A, B, C, D, and therefore their chargeable income is this amount. You've got it wrong completely. The examiner is testing your ability to to demonstrate the knowledge of presumptive tax, because 120 million is below 150 million, right? So you need to be very careful with that. Now, are there circumstances where somebody earning whose turnover is below 150 and can decide not to go the presumptive way? Yes. Section 4 says you can write to the commissioner and say, I don't want to be treated as a presumptive taxpayer. So for you, if you go into advisory, if someone asks you, should I choose to go full return or I be treated as a presumptive taxpayer? Which one is cheaper for tax planning purposes? Right? So you should be able to do the math and be able to understand so that you can advise your clients. Because they can choose to say, no, I don't want to be treated as a presumptive taxpayer. It's provided for. You write to the commissioner, you're granted. But what is cheaper? So that's an area under business income that I would like to take interest in. Another area that I want you to note down is initial allowance. That's still under business income. It's now section 27A. It was section 28, I think, but they made adjustments to section 27A of the Act. Now, scenario questions, okay, tell us the location of the business. That is the only information you're going to get. That will tell you whether this person qualifies for initial allowance or not, is the location of the business. Because we know that after a certain distance from Kampala, you qualify for initial allowance. So when you're reading scenarios, be very careful to identify the location of the business. Sometimes they'll mention the name of a district, right? So if the examiner tells you that this business is located in, let's say, maybe Kiruhura district or Busheri, you know that that is so many kilometers from Kampala, so the items there are qualified for initial allowance. So they will say, yes, this person put this item in business this year. So you should be able to demonstrate that you understand that these items qualify for initial allowance. So initial allowance is a very critical area. Now, once you get initial allowance wrong, you're going to get the wear and tear schedule wrong, you're going to get chargeable income wrong, and you're going to lose so many marks. Those are some of the areas I was telling you we need to pay a lot of attention to. So you find you have got a number of things correct, but you missed initial allowance, and so your wear and tear schedule is wrong, so you lose a number of marks there. The computation of chargeable income is wrong, and therefore the tax is wrong. Those alone will account for more than for about 5 to 6 marks. If you look at some of the solutions that have been shared, you see how the marks are being allocated. And I say, download these solutions and please be conversant with them. So you need to get some of those things right. Property income is section 20. That includes every income that is earned from rent, from investment in government securities and so forth. When dealing with this, be very careful with withholding tax. Because we know that under section 122, tax withheld on government securities is a final tax. What does that mean? Actually, I remember in one of the papers I was reviewing, the examiner asked the implication of withholding tax as a final tax. So they were asking you to write down what that would imply. And that's in section 1, I think 122. So the income that is earned from rent, I said, and government securities and any property is considered property income, including sports betting. Rental income, note this, the treatment for rental income is different for individuals and companies. That was amended in 2018. So that's where they'll bring an individual, they'll bring a company, and they'll ask you to determine the rental treatment for each of those two. That is different, and that is section 5 will tell you that, because that's where rent is covered. That's really it most about rent. It's a very simple area, it's a very small area, but it's always, I've seen in the past papers, it's always there. So it's an area that you can master and get some marks. Returns and assessments. This has been moved to Tax Procedures Code Act. Please take interest in them. Withholding tax, I already talked about withholding tax, section 122. It can be both theoretical, and they can also ask you a computational question on that. So take interest in that. Capital gains tax is section 50 of the Act. There are very interesting cases on capital gains tax because I think there's still a gray area in Uganda about capital gains tax. So because of that, it has raised a number of issues. There are cases of Baroda Bank, Bank of Baroda, the cases of that, the case I shared with you about Airtel and Zain, the case of the famous case of Talloway, you know. So you need to take interest in that, how those are treated, but it's under section 50, it's part of your examination syllabus. VAT is a separate act, the Value of Added Tax Act. You should be able to read it. I'm going to mention five things, five or six, that I expect you to note down when dealing with VAT. The first and the most important is listed institutions. I think that's the first schedule of the Act, and it's mentioned in section 45. How do we treat VAT for listed institutions? Let's say there's the United States Embassy. If you're supplying the US Embassy, it's a listed institution. It's a foreign mission, which is part of a listed institution. You're supplying an item, let's say furniture, that has VAT. How do you treat it? Because these people are not supposed to pay VAT. Do you remove the VAT from the invoice? So that's an area that you need to pay interest in. The next thing I want to talk about is VAT registration. At what point should somebody register for VAT? I've seen that a lot, the examiners like that particular bit. The third thing, talk about the tax rates. These tax rates are still an issue. I think it's the starting point of VAT. It should not be a problem to students. So let's take interest in the tax rates. I'm going to talk about the tax rates, but talk about the zero rate and the standard rate of 18%. Now, there are elements of VAT inclusive, which will bring you the element of 18 over 118. So those are the fractions, the VAT fractions that you need to take interest in. This should not be a problem. And this is where the heart of VAT is. You should be able to compute and know that if the item is provided me with inclusive of VAT, if a certain amount is inclusive of VAT, how do I remove the VAT from that amount? Okay? If the item is provided for me VAT exclusive, how do I put the VAT on that amount? Examiners will be playing around with these two things. They will say this item, VAT inclusive. This item, VAT exclusive. Or they can say all sales were VAT exclusive. All purchases were VAT inclusive. So they expect you to be able to use the fraction appropriately. It goes without mention, zero rated item and standard rated item, still under VAT. Now, these two disturb even tax experts for a simple reason. They keep changing them almost every year. This year, I find an item is zero rated. Next year, they will exempt it. The other year, they'll bring it back to zero rated. So this brings in the point that you should be conversant with current affairs. Okay, what is happening? What are the latest amendments? Examiners will not examine all things, no. And when they're marking or examining, I'm sure they don't put in feelings. They say, but this is new, so now let's first know. Once you get it wrong, you get it wrong. They will not award you mark for it. So we need to be conversant with the latest happenings in tax affairs. Pay attention to that schedule. I think it's schedule 2, the second schedule, and the third schedule of the VAT Act. It lists the items that are zero rated and the items that are exempt. And they will be changing every year. So if you're reading an old act, for example, water, drinking mineral water, I think at one point was zero rated. Now it is, I think, standard rated. Okay? So somebody needs to know. You should be conversant. I mean, you should be able to tell that they have made these changes. And you can only do that when you read the amendments. You are always post those amendments there. Or when you pay interest in what's happening. Sometimes they're written in the papers that, actually, when they read the budget,
you go in the papers, you'll see all the tax amendments there. They talk about it. They have put excess duty on this, they have removed this, they have, you know, all those changes. So take interest. What I do for myself is to photocopy those pages and file them somewhere so that I can always refer to them. So it's very important. So that's an area. The last one on that is computation of input and output taxes. VAT payable versus VAT claimable. At what point do I say VAT is payable? At what point do I say VAT is claimable? Some students, you know, when they realize that if I put input minus output, I'll get a negative, they'll change the formula. You know? But it actually means when you get a negative, maybe it is claimable. And maybe that's what the examiners are testing. Okay? So we should be able to know how to compute that. I'll briefly talk about customs because I want to move on to the next session. In customs tax, we need to pay a lot of attention to how to arrive at customs value. There are things that are included in arriving at customs value and there are things that are not included. To contain everything that we have seen and more. But for tax, it's also important that you get the latest material. Because like I've said, these things change every year. The act you are reading today may not be relevant next year. So you need to get the most recent material. So you should be able to collect material and read widely. So for me, once you have those three, you should be adequately prepared for the examination. If you read the comments, that I believe is public information, you realize that some students attempt less questions than required. Why? Maybe it's a problem of time. Right? And that's why time management is one of the things that we're looking at there. I can discuss this with time management simultaneously. You are given 3 hours and you have to get 100 marks. There are 5 questions that you're going to attempt. 3 hours is 180 minutes. Divide that by 5. Right? How many minutes are you supposed to spend on a particular question? Sometimes when you land on a question that you think is easy, you want to spend a whole hour on that question. No matter how much you exhaust that question, the best you can get is 20 marks. Right? So, what I would advise, time yourself. I used to have a watch, I still do have one. Always in the exam, time yourself. The moment the time for that question has elapsed, please move on to the next question. It's time up. However sweet the question is. Okay? Because you keep yourself time, you can do 4 questions, you end up attempting the exam out of 80. You have reduced your chance by a good percentage of passing. Right? And examiners have always mentioned these things in the comments. They've told us that students answer less questions, so we think probably it's because of time. But we have also had people say time was not enough. I wish they had added me more time. The 15 minutes provided for you to read, use that very importantly. Use it to outline what some of the points are. You know, use it to prepare which questions you're going to do. I always tell people start with the easiest question. Alright? Because your mind is fresh, you're able to maximize your efforts. So, identify the questions you're going to do within the 15 minutes. Write down some points if you want to or if you need to. It's important to write down because as you do the exam, chances are you'll start forgetting some things. Because the brain, it's a human brain, it's not a computer. Even computers start hanging when they heat up. Right? So, you'll get tired and you'll start forgetting something. So while you're fresh, it's important to note down. That's why they say rough work is at the back of the question paper, at the answer script. And then you cross it out at the end. So that will help you. So that when you're writing a point and you're stuck, you're able to go back and say, okay, I noted this, you can bring it this side, and you're able to move on quickly. Attempting more questions than necessary, you're cheating yourself. Because the examiners will not consider the 6th question. They will only consider 5. If they're generous enough, they might say maybe best 5, right? And so, what happens to the 6th question? You have cheated your time to rush through 6 questions, but they're only going to consider the best 5. Okay? So, topic spotting. This is a very common thing with students. I might say most of us probably did topic spotting. But let me tell you, it's very risky. Why? Because the examiners have mastered the art of being unpredictable. So they'll make sure they know these things. They'll make sure that they set questions that you cannot predict where the next question is coming from in the next city. Even if you read the entire paper from, I don't know, 20 what, you will still not be able to predict. So I advise people against question spotting and topic spotting. You can try, but you're taking a very big risk.